That was a bit chaotic. Oh, hey there, and welcome back to my channel. What you just saw was a quick montage of the new core and testand I've been working on. I had to destroy the old 3D printed core because the one snug fit of the coils turned into a you'll never get it off situation. That's why I'm making a new one. I took this opportunity to make some slight changes to the design. I ran some simulations in FEM 4.2 using Lua scripts to find a geometry with promising force output. The new core is made from cut steel wire and epoxy resin. The process was pretty straightforward. I 3D printed a mold from ASA, fitted with resin, and dropped in the wire cutoffs. However, I didn't include any draft angles since I was so lazy to square up the part after curing, which meant I had to destroy the mold to get the piece out. Next time, I would definitely use a 2 or more part mold. And I would also add threaded inserts for mounting. Drilling and tapping afterwards was a bad idea, and it was nearly impossible to do for me. One issue I ran into was the space between the track and the mover. I had to increase the gap to about 3 mm, because the attracting force not only tore the bolts, but also bent the entire rig. Definitely didn't see that coming. Ideally, the gap should be as small as possible. Moving forward, I plan to fill the cavities with concrete. It's not the ideal solution, but it's quick and effective. I will also replace some of the 3D printed parts with machined ones. Additionally, I want to upgrade the coils with returns, since I've now got some extra space. Lastly, you might have noticed I'm not using a linear encoder yet. I found an old rotary incremental encoder, belts and pulleys in a drawer, so I decided to use them for testing instead of buying a new one. Before we continue, I just want to take a quick moment to say a huge thank you to all of you watching. I honestly never thought my first video would be received this well, and it's been such a highlight for me. I also want to use this moment to apologize that this video took so long, but now I can make videos more frequently. At least they won't take 3 months. Alright, enough of being me all sentimental, let's get back to the video. Now that the hardware is almost complete, we need to configure the software and firmware. This part is a bit dry, so feel free to skip it. I'll try to keep it brief. First, let's clone an existing motor profile and input our own parameters. Start by giving it a name and entering the magnet structure, which in this case is surface mounted. Here we have the max voltage and current, but we don't know them yet. So we need to run an experiment to determine the current at which the forcer doesn't exceed a safe temperature. Next, we enter the phase resistance and inductance. Since the motor is wired in a Y configuration, we measure from the start point to one of the open leads. The BEMF constant tells us the voltage generated at 1000 RPM, and also the voltage required to reach a certain speed. For this, I recommend checking out ST's wiki page. It has helpful information on manual configuring motor parameters. There's just one thing I'm missing here, and that's a clear explanation of inertia and the friction coefficient, at least for the sake of completeness. Off camera, I did the measurement and calculated the BMF constant to be around 7.24 volt RMS, 1000 RPM. To calculate the inertia, let's imagine accelerating the forcer by pulling it with a rope and a winch. One winch rotation equals one electrical rotation, moving the forcer exactly 40 mm to the right. Now we just need a formula to calculate the torque required to accelerate our load. The forcer experiences a pulling force, which equals mass times acceleration. In rotation, the equivalent for force is torque, which equals inertia times angular acceleration. The angular acceleration of the winch is its tangential acceleration divided by its radius. When we plug these formulas together and simplify, we find that inertia I equals mass times radius squared. But what is R? Since one winch rotation moves the forcer 40 mm, the winch's circumference is also 40 mm, giving us a radius of 6.36. I weight the forcer, carriage and related component, which totaled 785 grams. Using this, I calculated inertia to be around 31.8 microkilogram meter squared, or in other units, micronewton meter second squared. Now, the term friction is strange, because the units are in micronewton meter seconds, which doesn't represent friction torque. According to the Junior Woodchuck's guidebook, this is likely a damping coefficient. Fortunately, this value is only crucial for sensorless control. The field-oriented control, using a high-sensitivity observer, requires an accurate mathematical model of the motor. Since we have an encoder, it mostly affects dynamics and control loop stability. For now, I set this to 1. If you have any ideas on how to measure or calculate this coefficient, let me know. Speaking of the encoder, what value do we need to plug in here? The pulley on the encoder shaft has 20 teeth with a 2 mm pitch. Moving the forcer 40 mm corresponds to one full encoder rotation, which outputs exactly 600 pulses. You see where this is going. Convenient. Since we have two pole pairs, the number of pulses for 80 mm of travel is 1200. And that wraps it up for the motor. Now, let's select our hardware. The IHM16M1 powerboard and the Nuclear F303 RE control board. Don't worry, we're almost done. We just need to make a few small adjustments. My power supply provides 12 volts, so I set the bus voltage to match this. Next, we switch the speed sensor mode from observer to quadrature encoder, which will also enable position control mode. In the speed sensing configuration tab, we can see the pins used for the speed sensor. I connect ground, plus 5 volts, and the two encoder outputs to the board. Although I initially connected the signals according to the pinout diagram, there were dedicated connectors intended for the encoder. I also disabled the driver protection feature, as it tends to trigger frequently when operating near the board's current limit. Under the drive settings tab, I switch the control mode to position control. If I wanted to test the system's force, which we'll do in a future video, I would change the setting to torque control. The software automatically calculates the control loop parameters based on the motor specifications we entered earlier. Any of these parameters can be adjusted in real time using the control software. Just ticking all these checkboxes to satisfy my OCD tendencies. Now, let's save the project and hit generate. You might encounter a few errors, and this is a known bug according to a post I can't remember where I came across online. However, despite the errors, the generated code should build and upload without any issues. Next, open and copy the path to your project folder. Now we open STM32CubeIDE and import the freshly generated project by clicking Open Projects from File System and pasting in the directory path. Make sure to select the STM32CubeIDE folder, then click Finish. Your project will now appear in the Project Explorer panel. Feel free to browse through the files. The most important ones to note are the .isc file, where you can modify the hardware configuration, and the main.c file, which contains the main program loop. For now, I'll leave everything as it is. Finally, all that's left to do is upload the program to the board. And that's it. We are ready to go. Once the program is uploaded, open ST's Motor Pilot software. From here, we can select one of a couple pre-made graphical user interfaces to control our motor. I go with the position control application, since we configured a project with a position controller. Now we can connect to our control board. Right here, we got our control panel. We also have access to a high frequency plot, in which we can save and export data. In the register tab, we are also able to plot some low frequency values, and the best is, we can add some custom variables, for example the readout of a load cell. I'll show how to do that when we do some performance tests in the future. Since this video is getting a bit long, let's take a moment to experiment with the system. By the way, I forgot to mention earlier that the setup uses not just one, but three cascaded controllers. The current controller, which manages the force and acceleration, the speed controller, which regulates velocity, and the position controller, which ensures precise positioning. This cascading structure significantly improves system response. We can visualize the motor's behavior by plotting the encoder's position and speed over time through a phase plot. The spirals in the phase plot represent oscillations along with their amplitude, frequency and damping. The small ripples you can see here are due to reluctance forces. These can be reduced by improving the magnet alignment or by carefully tuning the control system. For example, increasing the D-gain to help dampen these rapid changes in velocity. As you can see, there's a lot of room for optimization here. I'd love to hear your ideas in the comment section. With that said, thank you for watching and take care.